the question that I have for you, I want to start out, is Jesus central or supreme? Is Jesus central or is he supreme in your life? I want to begin with two verses out of Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 2, and I'm going to read them from the New Living Translation in answering this question before us. Kind of been in a theme of keeping Jesus central in our life. And so I want to read these two verses out of the New Living. If you have another translation, I'm sure you'll be able to keep up. But I just like the way that it stated it here in the New Living in a refreshing way. It says this: therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily hinders us, our progress. And let us run with endurance the race that God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, on whom our faith depends from start to finish. Love that translation, because it reminds us that we're in a journey. It calls it a race. And it says that there's things that try to get around us and get on us that slow us down or get us distracted. And the writer reminds us here in Hebrews that in order to persevere, we need to keep our eyes on Jesus, regardless of the circumstances that we're in. I don't have a lot of extra credit cards. I do that on purpose. I have the normal one or two, but I do have a Lowe's card. And my Lowe's card, I noticed that after I purchased it qualified for it, I guess. I didn't purchase it. I qualified for it several years ago. I noticed that I didn't write my check out to Lowe's. I wrote it out also to a bank called Synchrony Bank. And I thought, what in the world is Synchrony Bank? And so I was captivated by the title because it made me feel like that they were central to something, but I didn't know what. And so I did a little more investigation and I discovered that Synchrony Bank is really not a retail bank. I guess it has brick and mortars, but primarily or only what they do is that they essentially issue credit cards for retail stores. Over 100 retail stores are issued from Synchrony Bank, but you wouldn't know it. Because you have your JCPenney's and your Kohl's and your Texaco and your Chevron and your Care Credit. And you have all those cards that has the name of the retail store on the front. But in behind that card is Synchrony Bank. They are a central bank for credit cards. They essentially take the risk for retailers that they don't want to take. Their names, the retailer's name is on the card. But behind that is Synchrony Bank that says, we'll take the risk in order to make sure that people pay their bills, and if they don't, then we'll figure out how to go after them, so to speak. Now, when you think about Jesus, he's a little bit like Synchrony Bank in the sense that when people see us, they don't necessarily see Jesus, but yet in reality, they do see Jesus in what comes through us. And Jesus says, I'll take the risk to get into humanity. I'll take that risk because I believe it's a good risk, and I'll display myself through humanity, even though it doesn't look like on the surface, but yet in reality, I'm behind it. I'm in them. I'm shining through. Now, in a sense, Jesus is central within us. But the other thing is that Jesus is also supreme. Now, Synchrony Bank is not supreme. In other words, all the credit cards in the world don't come out of Synchrony Bank. There's other financial institutions that also have their credit cards they issue. So they're not supreme in a sense of all credit cards come out of that bank. But Jesus is supreme because if you want to have a relationship with the Father, you can only go through Jesus. So he is supreme in that respect. If you want to relate to the Father, you can only go through Jesus. And if you look up the word central, you'll find words like primary or essential or containing a center. If you look up the word supreme, you will find words like highest authority, degree, or quality, ultimate, and final. They're similar, but they're not the same. So let's jump in today and talk about, is Jesus just central in your life, or is he supreme? Let's find out. The birth of Jesus was received as being central. The angels told the shepherd, today in the town of David, a Savior has been born. He is Christ the Lord. What did they do with that message? They immediately, I don't know what they had planned for the rest of the night, but they immediately decided that they were going to go see this child that was announced to them by the angels. He became central to what they were doing that day. They felt like it was important enough that right then they leave the sheep and they go see Jesus. Some years ago, my father's passed away and my mother's still living. She's 95. Amazing mom. And I asked them several years ago to tell me about the time that they received Jesus into their life. And I'd never really thought about to ask the story before, but I did. And amazingly enough, they were similar, but not the same. My mom shared that she went to a meeting that was put together by a group of churches, as I understand. And she said that she just had a drawing that she wanted to receive Jesus into her life. She wanted to make Jesus Lord. And so she leaned over and asked her mom, can I go forward to receive Jesus? And her mom said, no, it's not the right time. I'm not sure what her reasoning were. Mom didn't know her reasoning. But she said, no, it's not the right time. The second night the meetings were held, mom said, I didn't ask my mom, I went forward. Because, yeah, she said, Jesus just became so meaningful and so desiring in her life, became so central, she had to act now. Ask no one, I've got to go. My dad had a similar experience in the sense that he said that God just began to speak to him so profoundly. He was a teenager at that time. That he said, it was almost like he was crying that he needed to respond. Because God had come over him. And he said, I needed to make Jesus Lord of my life. Now, my salvation experience wasn't quite that dramatic. But I've had other experiences since then that were. If I didn't respond then, because he was central in my mind, my understanding. If I didn't respond then, I don't know what would have happened. Because I responded. That's simple as that. I responded. And so there's times where Jesus becomes so central to us that we have to respond. I think of the story surrounding Jesus' birth. The birth of Jesus greatly intervened in people's routines. I have the point there for you. If you've ever had the privilege of being in a household where a baby is born, routines go out the window. You don't have a routine anymore because that baby becomes central. And so when Jesus was born, even our calendar reset because he's central to time. I just pulled out 6 things, and again, I'm going to go through them really fast about Jesus being central. Joseph made a decision to take Mary as his wife without really understanding why. Jesus became central in his life. Herod was threatened when Jesus was born. Why would this guy appointed by the Roman government be threatened by a baby being born? Jesus became central. The Magi traveled for miles. They saw this unusual star and they decided, we're gonna go for wherever that star is at because somebody important is underneath that star. He became central in their life. And then in Luke, we find the shepherds. It says, immediately after the angels were done, they said, let's go see this child. He became central in their life. When Jesus was 8 days old, when he was getting ready to be circumcised in the temple, being dedicated, Simeon came up and identified Jesus as being the promised Savior. And right on the heels of Simeon getting done, this old lady named Anna She was like 86 years old, came up, and again, she confirmed that Jesus was the Redeemer. All of a sudden, this little baby became central to everybody's lives, and even those who are waiting for the Savior to come. It's like they put away everything else, and Jesus popped up as central. When Jesus started his earthly ministry, and he completed that here on earth, he's still alive in heaven, and he told his followers, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go. All authority. And lots of times we read that or hear that, but we don't really stop to ponder. So if Jesus has all authority given to him, then how much does the devil have? None. If Jesus has it all, the devil has none. But how does he gain authority in our lives? Through deception. He lies to us. Through the life that we live and the world that we grow up in, he begins to lie to us. Look at that. That's good for you. Feels good. Do it. He lies to us. And he gains authority into our life when he really has none. Jesus says, I have all authority. He's not just central. He's supreme. Number two, as Jesus revealed the Father's plan, he became supreme. He became supreme. Colossians 1, 15 and 16 says this. And he says, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created. Things in heaven and on earth, visible, invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things were created by him and for him. You see, we don't oftentimes, we read that and we don't oftentimes stop and say, well, that makes Jesus supreme. Not just central. Not just a good man. Not just a great idea that lived. That means that if any moment Jesus would, in a sense, take the battery out of us, what would happen? We fall over, gone. Just like you take the battery out of something that's battery operated. What happens? It doesn't work. It's been created to work. The battery comes out. We are battery powered by Jesus. Really. And even, get this, even those that don't call him Lord are still battery powered by Jesus. That's an awkward one. That is true. What makes Jesus supreme? I don't oftentimes give up 8 minutes to somebody else in the middle of my sermon, but I'm going to do it today. John Piper, I don't know if you know that name, has a famous sermon that I've come across recently called The Supremacy of Christ. And I took just a segment. It's 50 minutes. I took a segment out. And you're not going to be able to comprehend the magnitude of what he says, but you will grasp the reality that Jesus is supreme. So we're going to take a look at it. 8 minutes. And just again, look at the reality that Jesus is not just central, but he's also supreme.
My prayer is that you will know, that you will press on to know the supremacy of Christ, the supremacy of his deity, equal with God the Father in all of his attributes, the radiance of his glory and the exact image of his nature. the supremacy of his eternality that makes the mind want to explode with the imponderable thought that Jesus Christ never had a beginning. He is simply there, absolute reality with which we reckon. We must rise to the supremacy of his eternality. While all the universe, including this building and your body and this earth and all the galaxies, are fragile, contingent, like a shadow in comparison to the substance of Jesus Christ. We must know the supremacy of his never-changing constancy. Oh, to have virtues that never change, a character whose commitment is constant, yesterday, today, and forever. Let us know the supremacy of his constancy. And let us know the supremacy of his knowledge that makes the Library of Congress look like a matchbox and makes all the information on the internet look like a 1940s farmer's almanac. Makes all of quantum physics and everything that Stephen Hawking has ever dreamed look like a first grade reader. We must know the supremacy of the knowledge of our Lord. We must know the supremacy of his wisdom that has never been perplexed by any problem whatsoever, nor can he be counseled by any person or any being in the universe. We must know the supremacy of his authority. All authority is mine in heaven and on earth and under the earth. No change. All authority. Changing times and seasons, removing kings, setting up kings, doing according to his will in the host of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. No one can stay his hand or say to him, "What have you done?" We must know the supremacy of his providence, without which not a single bird in the extended reaches of the Amazon forest has ever fallen off of any limb, and without which not one hair turns white or black. We must know the providence of Jesus. We must know the supremacy of his word, which upholds the universe by the word of his power. All the galaxies, molecules, atoms, and subatomic reality nobody has yet dreamed of. Down there where no one has yet looked. We must know the supremacy of his power to walk on water and cleanse lepers and heal the lame and open the eyes of the blind and open the ears of the deaf and cause storms to cease and with two words to raise the dead. Lazarus, come forth, or one word to raise the dead. In your blood, I said to you, live. We must know the supremacy of his power. We must know the supremacy of his purity. He never sinned. He never sinned. He never had one millisecond of a bad attitude or a sinful lust. We must know the supremacy of his trustworthiness. He never breaks a promise. He always keeps his word absolutely without fail. We must know the supremacy of his justice. He will render all accounts settled in the end, in the universe, either on the cross or in hell. No injustice will remain when Christ is finished with his supreme justice. We must know the supremacy of his patience. He has endured you and me for decades. He has endured this city and brings the sun. Can you imagine why the sun rose on this city this morning, this wicked city, this world so full of us-type sinners, and he makes paradise rise in the sky in Minneapolis? What kind of patience are we dealing with here? We must know the supremacy of His servant-like sovereign obedience, kept every one of His Father's commands absolutely, and in the end embraced the cross with total willingness. We must know the supremacy of His meekness and lowliness and tenderness. He will not break a bruised reed or quench a smoldering flax. We must know the supremacy of His wrath. One day it will explode on this world from heaven, such that all who have rejected Him will call for rocks to crush their brain, lest they have to face the wrath of the Lamb. We must know this. When I look at the beheadings and I hear someone ask, "Where is your supreme Christ?" my answer is really easy. He is in heaven storing up almighty wrath in fury to pour out on all those who commit such sins. That's where He is. And you better get right with Him and repent, or you will all likewise perish. It's not a hard question to answer biblically. We must know the supremacy of His grace, which gives to the spiritually dead rebels like us life, wakens faith in hell-bound haters of God, justifies the ungodly with His own righteousness. We must know the supremacy of His love, which dies for us while we are yet sinners, and gives to the absolutely undeserving the ability for ever-increasing joy in making much of Him. Must know the supremacy of His gladness. In the fellowship of the Trinity, infinite power, infinite energy, infinite joy rising, spilling over in the creation of a universe, and becoming for you one day an inheritance for every struggling saint. We must know this is what we were made for. Press on to know the Lord. We are made to know Christ. We're not made to do little diddly things. We're made to know this massive Christ. This world is little two-second slice, and then with Him or not, forever. It's what we are created to know and do and be about. And when we know Him in those ways, we have begun to know the outskirts of His supremacy. For time would fail to speak of His supreme severity and invincibility and dignity and simplicity and complexity and resoluteness and calmness and depth and courage. If there is anything admirable, if there is anything worthy of praise in all the universe, it is summed up in Jesus Christ.
Phew. Is He just central or is He supreme? I don't know. Every time I watch that, I get drawn in and I get empowered and I get refreshed. I can't get over the one statement that He makes, that if we would start to know Him in this way, we would just be on the outskirts of our God. Very, very powerful. What I want to look at, turn your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 2. I want to look at some things that Christ has done for us that there's no way that we could do for ourselves, and that's what makes Him supreme. So Hebrews. It was in Colossians, Hebrews. I'll be back in Colossians in a few moments. But Hebrews chapter 2, beginning at verse 14 through 18. There's six things in here that Jesus has done for us, and that's why it makes Him supreme. Let me read this and make a few comments. Verse 14 of chapter 2, Hebrews. Since the children have flesh and blood, He too shared in their humanity, so that by His death we might destroy Him who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death. Verse 16. For surely it is not the angels he helps, but Abraham's descendants. For this reason he was made to be like his brothers in every way, in order that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in service to God, and that he might make atonement for the sins of the people. And finally, because he himself suffered when he was tempted, he was able to keep those who are being tempted. There's six things in that those four verses that really set Jesus apart. First of all, as God, he shared our humanity. As God, he shared our humanity. Verse 14. We couldn't get up to God. We couldn't get righteous enough for God to accept us. And so Jesus came down. He came down. He lived among us. He was born of a woman. The seed was not from a man. He was born of a woman. He was fully human. The seed was from his heavenly Father. That's what makes him a miraculous birth that we celebrate here during this season. Sometimes you can't figure that out. You just have to accept it by faith. That he was born of a woman, but the seed was from his heavenly Father, impregnated by the Holy Spirit. The second thing that Jesus did for us is he breaks the power of the devil over our lives. He breaks the power of the devil over our lives. The only thing I mentioned earlier that the devil has over us is deception. To deceive us in some way, it looks good, it feels good, we think it's good, but it's not God. And Jesus speaks of himself as the truth. He is the truth. He didn't just bring the truth or teach the truth. He embodied truth. And so when we receive Jesus, we get truth. And darkness that has been difficult at times in our life suddenly turns to life. We see things different because we have Jesus. That's the second thing. The third thing is found in verse 15, is he frees us from our enemies. He frees us from our enemies. Whether he does it in this life or the next, he frees us from our enemies. It's a progressive thing. What would you consider at this moment your enemies? If you stop, what would be your enemies at this time? Would it be a time crunch? Would it be health uncertainty? Would it be a relationship difficulty? Would it be a job strain? Would it be children that are outside of the lines? Would it be a financial challenge? What would you consider to be your enemy right now? Jesus says that when you know the truth, you will be set free. Circumstances don't have to change in order for you to be set free. And then the next one, he is our merciful and faithful mediator. It calls us his high priest. That he's our high priest. What does it mean to be a mediator? Have you ever been in mediation? In my line of work, we call that marriage counseling. To be a mediator. If you get a good mediator, you have two people that are seeing things differently, and a good mediator will actually bring those two sides together, and both sides win. A bad mediator is one that lets one side win, the other side lose, and the mediator takes the big bucks anyhow. But that's not the kind of mediator that Jesus was. He was a good mediator. He was a faithful mediator. He was a merciful mediator. And when he came out of the mediation process, both sides won. We won and God won. Both of us won together. That's the kind of mediator he is. And if he hadn't mediated that to the cross, then we would lose and God would lose. Both sides would lose. Jesus mediated all the way through so that we could win and God could win. That's what makes him supreme. And then the next is that he suffered as our substitute. He suffered as our substitute. There's a verse in 2 Corinthians, maybe it's 1 Corinthians chapter 5. I believe it's 1 Corinthians chapter 5 that says Jesus was made sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. There's a hot debate at some points when it says that Jesus was made sin Did he ever sin? Was he made sin so that he could identify with sin? And some would say, well, the verse says he was made sin somehow. But I contend to say we don't understand that verse, because if he would have ever sinned a millisecond, that would have disqualified him from being our Savior. One slip up, one millisecond of sin, that would have disqualified him totally to become our Savior. So what did he do? He suffered for us. That which we should have taken on, he took for us. He suffered as a sinless human being. He took on the punishment to satisfy God's wrath. He took it on himself. It's hard for us to understand and grasp that that's a reality of what Jesus said. He says, you couldn't do it, but I'll do it for you. These two illustrations are pale in comparison, but perhaps it helps you understand. If we went out to dinner after we finished and you ate what you ordered and you got the ticket of your food and I reached over and took the bill of your food and paid it for you, you ate it, you should have paid it, but I reached and took the bill for your food and I paid it. Again, it's a pale comparison of what Jesus did, but sometimes it gets us into the illustration of what he did for us that we can't grasp. Another illustration would be that if I needed to discipline one of my children and I took him into a room and instead of me using the paddle, I gave them the paddle and they paddled me as the parent. That would be another illustration of how Jesus suffered on our behalf when he didn't do a thing. And then finally, he restrains temptation for us. Verse 18. He was human just like us. And I don't know where you're tempted or how you slip up, but you need to understand this morning that Jesus Christ was tempted in every way that you and I are, yet was without sin. He had the ability to restrain that we don't think that we can. And yet with Christ in us, with him living inside of us, he can conquer what we can't. And that's what makes him more than central. It makes him supreme. Six things coming out of Hebrews chapter 2. Let me finish up here in Colossians. You can go back to Colossians if you journeyed to Hebrews. Colossians chapter 3, to move from Jesus being central to supreme, there's several things that we must be reminded of, perhaps even do. Colossians chapter 3. First of all, let me read chapter 2, 9 and 10. For in Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form. Now catch this next phrase. If you have a bulletin, circle it. If you have a Bible, underline it. And you have been given fullness in Christ, who is head over every power and authority. Colossians 2, 9 and 10. Having Jesus in our life is a game changer. Colossians 3, 1 through 4. Four things there that we need to be reminded of. It says, since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Where is your heart set this morning? See, our hearts can be set on things of this world. Not necessarily intentionally, just that we're in the flow and our hearts get set on the things of this world and the way the world thinks about things. And we need to be jolted for a moment to say, wait a minute, where is my heart set? Is it set on things above? See, when it goes, first of all, through things above, then the earthly things take their order in place. Proper order in place. And so my question to you is, where is your heart set this morning? Is it set on being successful? Is it set on being liked by others? Is it set on pleasing someone that you could never please? Is it set on resolving that something or someone would never change, where is your heart set this morning? And then when you identify where your heart is set, he goes on in the second verse and he says, set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. You see, our minds begin to work out what our heart is set on. You say, well, what is my mind thinking about? Your mind is trying to work out what your heart is set on. And if you change your heart set, your mind would begin to work differently because your heart is set on someone or something else that's different. And so your mind then takes that into account where your heart has already set the direction to go. Is your mind set on things above where your heart is? I think it was last week that it takes 21 days to change a habit, but 63 days to change a mindset. The third thing that is mentioned here is that you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. For you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. What does that mean? It means that to know that our old nature is not in charge anymore. Your divine nature, which now is in you, is ready for activation. Your old nature is dead unless you resurrect it. It's dead unless you and I resurrect it. That's the growing process that we're in. And we have to realize that sometimes in the midst of life and things and growth that we resurrect that old nature and it responds to circumstances and begins to worry and begins to fret when in reality it should be dead. And yet, how often we resurrect it. We should wake up every morning as Christians and say, my old nature is dead. My new nature lives. New nature, what are we going to get into today? That would be a game changer, wouldn't it, for the day? And finally, verse 4 says that when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory. What a great verse. We now live in ongoing transformation. We live in ongoing transformation. We haven't just received Jesus and now we wait around until he comes. We are in ongoing transformation to become like him. That when we recognize him and he recognizes us, that we're more alike than different. I guarantee you, if you keep journeying with Jesus through your life, when he returns, you're going to say, that's him, because I'm a lot like him. And he's going to look at you and say, that's my son and my daughter, because they look a lot like me. We're in an ongoing transformation process if we decide that we want to stay ongoing. He gives us a choice. Let me end where I began. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life, there's a lot of people that said yes to God way before we did. And they're hanging around the balconies of heaven. And they're saying, come on, you do on earth. I did it, so can you. You can make it all the way through. I did it, so can you. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, and especially the sin that so easily hinders us. Wow. And let us run with endurance the race that God has set out before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, on whom our faith depends from start to finish. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that Jesus is not just central, but he is supreme. And I pray, God, that as we reflect upon where he is in our lives this Christmas season, that we would put him not just at the place of central, but we would recognize he's also supreme. And I pray, Lord, in these few moments that we would examine to see where our hearts are set at and what our minds are thinking upon. And whether we're even aware that in knowing Jesus and living for him, that our old life is dead and a new life has begun. And that we are engaged in ongoing transformation. God, thank you that you are the only one that can change us. Our parents can't change us. The laws can't change us. Pastor can't change us. Our spouse can't change us. We're the only one to give you permission to change us. And so, Father, today we come to this place. We hold our lives before you in a balance and say, Jesus, come and be Lord. Come and be Lord of my life. And maybe you want to agree with that for the first time or another time. Jesus, come and be Lord of my life. I want you not just to be central, but come and be supreme. Show me what that means for me to walk out daily in my life. God, thank you that you have the answers and we don't. But when we seek you, we will find the answers. And we thank you, God, that you delight in giving us the answers. Your answer is good. Your answer is right. Your answer may not be popular. But when it comes from you, you're the one that really matters. Grow us today, God, into your likeness. In Jesus' name, amen.